He's buff, he's tough, he can go the distance. Introducing the Greek superhero himself, Hercules.
Hercules, Hercules, Hercules.
This wonder boy started out scrawny, insecure, and singing probably one of the best ballads in Disney movie history. This beautiful song was sung by a Broadway veteran. But who could put such tenderness in this heroic song? Let's find out. Before we start, don't forget to check out our Patreon, our Discord, and of course, like and subscribe. Roger Bart was born in Norwalk, Connecticut. I said Norwalk. Anyway, he later grew up in Bernardsville, New Jersey in 1962. The son of a teacher and a chemical engineer, Roger was never really exposed to theater, nor was it something he knew he wanted to do with his life. He was, however, heavily influenced by Looney Tunes, and specifically Daffy Duck.
You're despicable.
Sorry, Daffy, but this is a Disney show. Still, it wouldn't be long before the theater called to him.
I started off when I was in fourth and fifth grade, mm-hmm. and I had a conversation with it was back in the days when they had the Tams Whitmark scripts, and Tams Whitmark would rent the scripts to something like Oliver, mm-hmm. and they would only include the pages in the script that you talked, and then so I was always at that age I was thought, well, I have to have the, I have to get the thickest script, and that would be the lead role, and I was given the role of the Artful Dodger, and my sister picked me up at school, and I was crying afterwards, and she said, oh no, man, this is, you're doing the great role, you're doing the funny role, he's cool, you know, Oliver's a,
yeah,
I won't say. and so you know, I didn't know it, but actually she was predicting really my career, because I always played the, you know, the second or third lead. It was really fun and funny, and it was a great part. So,
and that's something that was easy for you.
Yeah,
because it's
yeah.
not easy for most people.
No,
I
was
think.
Really, you know, it was
it's tricky.
It took to it.
Roger continued to sing and perform through high school and earned his BFA in acting from Mason Gross School of the Arts in Rutgers. This is where he met an interesting teacher.
One of my favorite things that she taught me was first of all, it was way, way beyond my singing capability, but I had to sing that song. Take all these, you lucky man, and I had to sing the words, take then all these, you lucky man, if you can. I just sing, if you can, if you can.
Uh-huh.
That's the end of the song. And she convinced me that the best way to sing that would be to sing Ophio Cone with a covered tone. So I sang Ophio Cone. And I finished the first performance of it. And I had a bunch of friends come to the show, and they said, that was unbelievably funny what you did. To actually decide to do the Dudley Do-Right thing you're doing was so amazing. And of course, I was trying to sing my best. I just said,
yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, great.
Okay,
thank
I'll
you.
Take it. Yeah.
Luckily, he didn't sing like this for long. He eventually learned to let his natural voice come through, which is good for us because Roger's voice is beautiful. Like most actors fresh out of college, Roger decided to try his luck in New York. Unlike most actors, however, he didn't have a do-or-die mentality.
What I did was create sort of a kind of a deadline for myself in terms of whether or not I should stick it out or
uh-huh.
not. And I fortunately kind of barely made it, but I'm glad I did, you know. So I thought by age 30, if I'm not making a living, for me, I felt that since I was not just all about acting and growing up loving it, it wasn't like that for me. I was a diverse person. I'll do something else.
Right.
You know? So I gave it till 30 and I made it, you know, again, by a hair.
Almost right out of college, Roger debuted on Broadway in 1987 when he replaced John Short as Tom Sawyer in Big River.
I was sent in by a lady who was handled infants for television commercials into a Big River audition, and there the late and great Stanley Sobel saw me and screened me and brought me in, and then I met Des McAnuff and ended up doing Tom Sawyer in the first national tour of Big River, which was a terrific show and a great part. And it was a lot of fun. Unfortunately, it led me to believe that I would always just walk into auditions and just get Broadway first national tours and jobs.
The award-winning show was incredibly well-received, and though he didn't personally win any awards for the role, Roger was a big part of why the show went so well. The show itself won 16 awards. Unfortunately, Big River closed 6 months later, and Roger would have to wait 4 more years to get another part. He didn't spend this time moping, though. Roger had become good friends with composer, lyricist, and playwright Jonathan Larson. Together, they workshopped Suburbia, for which Roger performed the hero in all the auditions and performances. He was also involved in developing Tick, Tick, Boom, streaming now on Netflix. Come on, let's get Andrew Garfield that Oscar nom, baby! Excuse me. And the hit musical, Rent. He and Jonathan recorded an early demo of the song from Rent called, well, Rent, with Jonathan as Mark and Roger as, well, Roger. Yep, that's right. Part of the reason for the character Roger's name was because of Roger Bart. 1992 saw Roger's career finally kicking off when he played Dickon in The Secret Garden and the following year, Cousin Kevin in The Who's Tommy. In 1994, Roger moved to L.A. to try his luck in Hollywood.
So I came to Los Angeles with nothing. And two things happened, though.
Mm-hmm.
I got my first television job playing George Carlin's son.
Yeah.
And I got my a dream come true role being the singing voice of Hercules. And, you know, of course, the whole song, one of the reasons I think I got it was because the song was about feeling out of place and feeling like I was, that I kind of felt that I was special somehow. And yet no one seemed to really recognize that and here.
Yeah.
And so I sang this beautiful song about
you really felt that.
Oh, I really did. Yeah. And so I, you know, I sang for Alan Menken and he just wept. Of course he weeps at every other person audition.
But still don't leave that
but
second
I love
part
him.
Out, man.
No,
awesome.
I love him. He knows he's a weeper.
Wow.
But the whole song was about like, you know, seems like no one thinks too much of me here. And they're glad to tell it to my face. And they're right, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm completely out of place. And so I thought, yeah, I understood it.
I can do this.
Yeah, and so that was the great gift of that, and that was a real, you know, it was something I really wanted to do to always have that somewhere in the world.
Yeah, yeah. I can go the distance. I don't care how far. Somehow I'll be strong. I know every mile will be worth my while. I would go.
Soon after recording for Hercules, Roger moved back to New York, where in 1997 he performed Jonathan in King David and Harlequin in Triumph of Love. But 1999 proved to be his biggest year when he landed the role as Snoopy in the revival of You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. I feel every now and then that I gotta fight someone. I know every now and then what I wanna be. A fierce jungle animal crouched on the limb of a tree. I'd stay very, very still till I see a victim come. I'd wait knowing very well every second counts. And then like the fierce jungle creature I am, I would pounce! I'd pounce! Ay, 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 ay! You know, I never realized it was so far down to the ground from up here.
I remember thinking that the key to doing the part was, that the rest of the cast were my well-intentioned staff. That from Snoopy's perspective, that's what his feeling was about all of them. What time is dinner? Shouldn't you be scratching me at this point? Stuff like that. So yeah, it was a gas, man.
But
yeah.
Having rehearsed with you, I joked with you, but I remember when we started Charlie Brown in Chicago, I remember you so clearly outside in the parking lot in front of a dumpster working Snoopy's bits over and over and over again until they were in you so completely.
And natural. Yeah.
So natural and so hilarious.
Yeah, well, you know, the old vaudeville, you know, it those guys that did all of those vaudeville, you know, and there's a lot of vaudeville in Charlie Brown, what we did.
Mm-hmm.
And the vaudeville guys toured the same shtick throughout the towns, you know, before television, and everybody, and they did the same routines over and over again. So
something that happens with all clowning is that you try to achieve that level of ease and perfection without it ever looking like work.
Right.
Now cut that out! Now why can't you eat your meal quietly and calmly like any other normal dog?
So what's wrong with making mealtime a joyous occasion?
For his hard work, Roger won a Tony for Best Featured Actor in a Musical. Finally.
I think the day that I got my Tony in the mail, which you get later with your engraving, I had an audition for the voice of Jared from Subway, of the voice of his pants. So just to go to show you that the day you receive your Tony is not nearly as glamorous as the day you actually are sort of told you're going to get your Tony.
Roger's next notable performance came in 2001 with his performance as Carmen Gia in Mel Brooks' hilarious musical, The Producers.
I was out in Sag Harbor at the, wonderful theater?
The Bay Street, Bay Street Theater.
I was there with the voice of Piglet, and so, you know, I'd always just make him talk dirty to me on the rooftop when
we would all drink. What are you talking about? Who's the voice of Piglet?
Oh, I think he passed. I can't.
You mean literally like the voice of Piglet?
Yeah.
And he was in the play with you?
He was. And so, you know, I'd always try to get him, you know, inebriated enough to speak a dirty Piglet to me. And I was going to have the opportunity to audition for Mel Brooks as Franz Liebkind, who was the big German, for those of you who aren't familiar with it. He's
right.
A giant German, played by Kenneth Mars in the original movie. And I thought, you know what? Mel Brooks, Susan Stroman, I'm going in no matter what, even if I wasn't necessarily spot on. I sort of was in a spiritual way, I think.
Right.
I loved the part. So I went in, and there were, of course, you know, a room filled with 6'2", you know, giant blonde sausages, you know, giant people, you know.
I know.
Huge people.
I dated all of them at one point.
And I went in, and, you know, I walk in, and as Mel is so inclined to do, basically has no editing skills. He just kind of went, "He's too small, Stro. He's too small," you know. So I went in.
Could you hear him saying that?
Yeah. I did the number, and I walked out. And then probably Andy Zerman, wonderful casting director, he said, you know, Stro, and I think they looked at each other, they said, "Why don't you just have him read Carmen Gia while he's here?" Probably what got me the job was I opened the door and say yes, and it said it was spelled, you know, Y-E-S-S-S, as to imply a slight lisp, I imagine. But I interpreted as holding out the S for as long as I literally humanly can. So I held it out for about 45 seconds when I did it. And Mel Brooks, I think he started to weep. I think he couldn't believe that I would be as outrageous as that.
Right.
You know? And anybody who knows Mel's world knows that, you know, being outrageous is a great thing. Even if you fail, it's at least just go out there and give it a shot.
Were they dying laughing?
Oh, my God.
In the moment?
Yeah, it was so funny. I knew the movie fairly well, but when they hand you sides there that they know you've never looked at, it's wildly liberating because you, A, go with your first instincts.
Totally.
And B, you are given the great pass of not knowing.
That's right.
You're just waiting.
You cannot be held responsible.
That's right. Yeah,
that's so amazing. So did you kind of know, like, I just did that thing?
No, I knew that they loved me, and it was really nice. It was so helpful to me, and my you know, my second daughter was born in the first preview in Chicago, and, you know, I needed a job.
Yeah.
So it was kind of an amazing gift.
The person who had done the role in the original movie, Andreas Foutsinos, I think is a Greek fellow who, he gave me such a wonderful launch pad from which to kind of do what I wanted to do. And also, you know, the costumes and the amazing words of Mel and Gary Beach as a partner. You know, I quietly snuck more and more cheesy bits in that show because they liked the scene. And I had so little to do in the show, I just very quietly kind of tried to make the part bigger and bigger, like Fred Applegate, bigger and bigger and bigger, and Andrea Martin, as much as I could. And then and somehow they just suddenly turned around and went, "Wait a minute, what has he done? Why is this scene now 11 minutes long?"
Think of the Tony!
Tony, 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 Tony!
Ah.
What's the matter?
Oh, is he all right?
He's having a stroke.
What?
Of genius!
I see it at last. The chance to do something important.
Roger Debris presents history.
Of course, that whole second act has to be rewritten. They're losing the war, excuse me. Let's do downbeat.
Roger Debris presents history.
We felt that we could get away with anything if we just were the healthiest and most loving couple. They were very nervous about the scene because of the time, I guess, and it required fully going there.
That was a thrilling experience, and I was old enough to know that it was so special, that it was going to be special, and I played a lot of roles like that afterwards for a while too.
What, super gay guys?
Yeah, super gay, funny, you know, flamboyant, which is fun because it. Again, you know, it if you are afforded an opportunity to be hammy or large, it's just fun.
Right.
Roger also had the opportunity to perform Leo Bloom as well.
I've just got to be a producer. Drink champagne until I puke. Drink champagne until I puke. Be a producer. Show the world just what I got. And I'm gonna show.
The producer still currently holds the record for most Tony Awards, winning 12 awards out of 15 nominations.
It's good to be the king.
During this time, he had a few guest appearances on Law & Order and a reoccurring role in Bram and Alice. He also played the singing voice of Scamp in Lady and the Tramp 2.
I never had this feeling before. She gives me shakes and shivers I can't ignore, and I see that there's more now than just running free.
2004 was another big year for Roger. He performed Xanthius in The Frogs and was cast in a reoccurring role in Desperate Housewives.
They asked me if I loved you.
What did you say?
I said no. But according to the polygraph, that wasn't exactly true.
Well, I don't know if that means anything. Polygraphs aren't completely reliable.
I think perhaps the machine picked up on something that I wasn't aware of.
Wow.
On my last day I shot that, the part was so, I didn't know what it was going to be. The Mark Cherry, who created the show, my second or third day, said, "Do you know what you want to hear? Where the character's going?" And I was like, yeah, that'd be nice."
Right.
He goes, "Well, you're going to be a sociopathic stalker," and I went, "Oh." And so I started to get kind of creepy immediately. But when I was dying in the last episode that I did, because I did like 17 of those things.
Yeah.
I said to the director, "You think I'll ever work again after this?" And he goes, "Oh no, this is your Gilligan." So it was really funny. I mean, I loved some of the stuff I had to do, but it was always funnier to me than a lot of people in the country who I'd see at airports would say things like, "My wife hates you," shit.
Right.
Like that. So it was hard. I always thought I was so funny.
Yay, thanks.
Thanks so much.
My autograph?
Yeah. I mean, people would actually, I would go to bars and they would cover their cocktails because they were afraid I would poison them. Come on.
Since then, Roger has had a steady stream as guest stars and reoccurring roles in television. However, he found he was being stereotyped.
It was like you play one and then you're just in it. And that's what I mean about Desperate Housewives. I had never done that. And it was kind of fun because it was different. But then it got a little old when, like every show I did, it was always like, ew, you had to go out with him. Like I think I did a 30 Rock and... Tina Fey, went out on a date with me and would sort of, bartered offering up sexual services in order for me not to fire her employees. It was a certain theme, which is sort of like, ew. I would just sort of say, ew. That's what I was sort of, I was ew for about 7 years. I kind of wanted to be just funny again.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It gets a little old, but unfortunately there was other shows like, I've been on Episodes, which is a great show, really funny on Showtime. And, I started to kind of come around to getting more comic stuff, but it takes a while to break what it is that you do. And here, I get to be clowns. Mm. And I look back at stuff. Most of them are bad guys generally, but funny bad guys like Daffy Duck. And he's my favorite, so.
In 2007, Roger returned to Broadway and to Mel Brooks, where he originated the role of Dr. Frederick Frankenstein. Oh, I'm sorry, Dr. Frederick Frankenstein in Young Frankenstein.
Brits, Transylvania Mania. It's the newest quip from Mount Gonquinwitz.
It's the winning horse that never quits.
It's the paprikash with an ice cold schlitz.
To the Transylvania Mania.
Played by Horowitz.
It's serving Berlin's putting on the ring.
He came to the show. Gene Wilder was in my dressing room. And I said, well, that must have been weird. He said, yeah. And I said, how did you like it? And he goes, I liked the dancing. That killed me.
In 2016, he originated the role of Tony in Disaster.
You threw this pier directly into a bomb mine.
Well, we're not on the pier.
But the casino is attached to the pier, and your guests will soon cause their own deaths.
How are my guests going to trigger an earthquake?
Vibration.
From?
The hustle, the bump, that, every funky dance move shakes the pier, will so soon cause the bomb mine to snap.
You lost me, Professor.
You need to get everyone off this casino.
Are you crazy?
No. The doctor said that humorless is not the same thing as crazy.
And most recently in 2020, Roger originated as...
Great Scott!
Doc Brown in Back to the Future, the musical in England.
You know, when I got that little email saying, how would you like to put yourself on tape for Doc Brown, it was like, oh, how do I... let me get started. And then I tried to kind of find things in my house that could sort of work, so I had a lampshade on my head and a bathrobe and was looking pretty crazy up in my bedroom in L.A. I found this karaoke vibe thing. I had for like $1.99, I purchased the Talking Heads David Byrne song Once in a Lifetime, which I thought was like a really apropos song because I spent a lot of it going, you may find yourself in another part of the world. And that to me was, well, this is perfect. You want to find something that at least fits to some extent with the character, and Once in a Lifetime was like, so I felt good about the tape. Our producer, Colin Ingram, still sort of threatens to drag it out at some party at some point, but I beg him not to.
Me, the connection after decades of rejection. I never really thought I'd get to see how well. It works! It works! It works! Alright, I can keep on fluxing in a new kind of reduction, cause it works! It works! It works! I found what I was searching for, it's called the flux capacitor, and this is breakthrough scientific first!
Roger Bart's sweet, angelic voice was a perfect match for young Hercules. On top of that, his performance in many movies, shows, and on Broadway proved that he has both amazing comedic timing as well as a flair for the dramatic. We will definitely be watching his career to see what he brings us next. So with all that being said, can anyone spot us some tickets to London and maybe a performance of Back to the Future? Thank you to these people for your generous support, and a special thank you to John David. You guys are really helping keep this channel afloat. Thank you. Thank you for watching this episode of Discographies. Don't forget to check out our Patreon and Discord, and click the thumbs up button below if you liked the video. And if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, subscribe and click the bell. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked below. We hope to see you in another Discography.